Good morning, Heritage Academy, and family and friends, all those that are viewing on Facebook or YouTube. We pray that you all have had a wonderful night's rest, and we ask and pray that God would be with us this morning as we lift our voices in song. Our first song will be, for those of you that are joining us, hymn number 190. And for the students, you should have the words on the screen.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, He who died, heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sins, let His little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. Jesus, take this heart of mine, make it pure and holy thine. The cross You died for me, I will love and live for Thee. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so.
Amen. How many of y'all know that Jesus loves you? Amen. Praise the Lord. Our next song will be hymn number 422, Marching to Zion.
Join in a song with sweet accord, and thus surround the throne, and thus surround the throne.
Sing it out, brothers and sisters.
We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, that beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, may speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, that beautiful city of God. The hills of Zion yield a thousand sacred sweet. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, or walk the golden streets, or walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heaven.
Amen. Our next song is one that most of you should know. It's the song, You Are My Hiding Place. And what we're going to do this morning is we're going to sing it once through as a group, and then we'll do a round. The guys will start off, and then the girls will come in. All right? Let us bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you so that we can truly trust in you, Father. We thank you for all your precious promises and your word, and we thank you, Lord, for the series that we've been hearing this week by Elder Baker. Lord, we pray that you would speak to him, to us, that we will receive, retain, and be able to reproduce what we learned today. Father, we thank you and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of the Word, and after 2 years of that study, he became convicted that in about 25 years, the end of the world would come in 1843. But he wanted to be sure that he was right, so he studied for 5 more years to verify everything that he had come up with, and so that brings us to 1823. 1823 is 20 years before 1843. And it's interesting, 20 years after 1843, the Seventh-day Adventist Church was formed. So there's as much time going into the Millerite movement as there is to the Sabbatarian Adventist movement that brought about the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, we brought our study to 1843 yesterday, and I need to talk to you about Samuel Snow. Samuel Snow was born in 1806, and he had a conversion experience when he was 17, but he later lapsed into unbelief. And then early in 1840, his brother gave him a copy of William Miller's lectures, and he kind of felt like that would help him overcome his skepticism, which it did. Snow soon became a close study of the Adventist writings. He later became an independent preacher. He began to herald the imminent second coming of Christ. And he was gripped by the tremendous truth that the Savior was returning soon. At that time, he understood in just 3 years. And in 1843, he offered his services to the Millerites, and he was ordained and became a pastor. And he took, this is his words about after his brother gave him that book. So what he said was, "I took the book home, I read it, and the more I read it, the more I was impressed with its truth. I compared it with the scriptures. I saw at once that it contained an argument that could not be rejected. I saw that everything was complete. I saw the perfect harmony between Daniel and Revelation, and the history which is a perfect fulfillment of these revelations. I asked myself in all seriousness, how could this great knowledge be obtained unless it were inspired by God? Then I saw that the Bible, which I had so long rejected, was the Word of God, and I melted down before it." So that's his account of his conversion experience by reading William Miller's works. Now, Miller had predicted that Christ would come sometime between March 21st, 1843 and March 21st, 1844. That's because the Jewish year doesn't start when our year starts. It starts typically in March or April. So he knew for sure 1843. He didn't know more details. In spite of all Miller's careful study and his meticulous calculations, though, that whole year passed. And there was, obviously, no second coming. So kind of a little depression set in. People were perplexed. They didn't know what to do, so they turned to their Bibles, and people saw this text from Habakkuk, chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. "And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain upon tables." Well, the Millerite chart is a table, and it makes the vision plain. Goes on to say, "that he may run that readeth, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. At the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come and will not tarry." And so here they saw in this verse that the vision was yet for a future time. They weren't sure when, and they knew that they were in what they called the tarrying time. They also studied the parable from Matthew 25 that Jesus gave about the second coming, which is the parable of the 10 virgins. And in the parable, they noticed the word tarried again. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, the cry was made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." So again, this was encouraging to them. They saw themselves in that experience, and they were somehow enduring a tarrying. They still didn't understand what the tarrying was for. Now, this is from Samuel Snow's little book. It's really a pamphlet. It talks about, again, the 490-year prophecy, and it mentions that Paul was converted in the fall of A.D. 34. Jesus Christ was crucified in the midst of that week, the A.D. 27 to A.D. 34 period, and he was crucified in the spring at Passover, and then, therefore, that seven-year period, since the crucifixion is right in the middle at 3.5 years, the beginning of the period had to begin in A.D. 27, in the fall. And he goes on and he reasons, from that point, from A.D. 34 in the fall, 1,810 years remained in the 2,300 days. You add the 1,810 to the A.D. 34, and that brings you to 1844. He also said that Jesus was crucified not just in the spring, but on the very day of Passover, And not just any time at Passover, but at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he died at the same time the Passover lamb is supposed to be slain. So he saw that to the smallest detail, the prophecies of Christ's first coming were fulfilled, and on the actual day that they're supposed to be fulfilled. So he drew the conclusion then that the judgment in 1844 would also have to fall on the exact day of the Day of Atonement. Snow first started preaching this. He had this, and remember, this is now into 1844, and so the days are approaching, so time is moving fairly quickly. Snow preached in the large Boston Tabernacle on the text, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh." That's from the ten virgins parable. And then he puts this in parentheses, on the 10th day of the 7th month. The 10th day of the 7th month is the Day of Atonement. So he's connected those two things. And then he says, "Go ye out to meet him." This began to arouse some of them from their apathy, because they had waited for that whole year of 1843 for the second coming. There was no second coming. They're like, is there ever going to be a second coming? So they were a little apathetic. But this began to change things. Now, coming down to August, they had a large camp meeting in Exeter, New Hampshire, and it was from August 12th to August 17th. And it's kind of a dramatic thing that Samuel Snow comes riding up on a horse while Joseph Bates is speaking. And I'll share you some of what James White said about that. So it ended up that Samuel Snow stepped to the podium and began to speak. And so he had three discourses. The first was that on 1844, that's the ending of the great prophetic time periods. The second talk that he had was on the Mosaic sanctuary service types and their fulfillment in the Christian experience. And then the third thing that he talked about was that the crucifixion was in the midst of the 70th week, which I just went over with you. Then he concludes, in consequence, the close of the 2300 years would similarly extend to the 7th month of 1844, that's the 7th month of the Jewish year, which would be in the month of October. Now, Joseph Bates is the one who was speaking, and this is what James White said about it. James White was very polite. He just left a blank where Joseph Bates' name is. I guess I'm not as charitable. I put it in there. Just then, as one, Joseph Bates, was speaking with but little force and interest, and the people were becoming weary of being told in a dull, prosy style what they already knew, a middle-aged, modestly appearing lady arose in the center of the audience and in a calm manner and in a clear, strong, yet pleasant voice addressed the speaker as follows. It is too late, Brother Bates. It is too late to spend our time upon these truths with which we are familiar and have been blessed to us in the past and have served their purpose and their time. So Brother Bates sat down. And the lady continued, while all eyes were focused upon her, it's too late, brethren, to spend precious time as we have since this camp meeting commenced. Time is short. The Lord has servants here who have meat in due season for his household. Let them speak, and let the people hear them. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. That's really awkward. You know, if one of you did that to me, I don't know how I would handle that. But Brother Bates did sit down, and Brother Snow stepped up. This testimony seemed electrifying and was responded to by choked utterances of amen from every part of the encampment. Many were in tears. So then, just a couple weeks later, he publishes his pamphlet, The True Midnight Cry, on August 22nd, 1844, and that was scattered everywhere in various forms. It was printed in all the Adventist newspapers, and the book was printed by the thousands, hundreds of thousands. This really amazing movement shared, starting at Exeter, the camp meeting, spread quickly throughout the other Millerite camps and general meetings, preaching the time, or the definite time, as taught by Snow, was soon taken up by hundreds of Millerite leaders. So they've gone from preaching that Jesus would come sometime in 1843, the Jewish year 1843, to now preaching a definite time. They know exactly when he's supposed to come. It's going to be October 22nd, 1844. As the day of expectation approached, the Adventists literally gave all their all to advance the cause they had espoused. They began to sell their property and possessions in order to finish the carrying of God's last message to men. Large sums of money were so dedicated. They wished to have all dealings with their fellow men honorably concluded. So all debts were paid, and they even helped pay the debts of those who were less fortunate. Intensity marked the closing days. A quickened tempo, a greater urgency took possession of men, like the fervor of the crusaders of old, as the movement swept towards its intense climax. The Boston steam presses rolled at top speed 24 hours a day to turn out Adventist papers for distribution, and they did not charge for the papers. They funded the papers completely with their own money. All the way from Maine to Ohio and Canada down into the South, living messengers went from house to house in city and village and from farm to farm in the country with the last warning message. The last known wrong was righted. The last confession was made. Incidentally, this had an inevitable effect upon the populace about. Certain hardened criminals were led to give themselves up for trial. Others made restitution where they had been dishonest. And the United States Treasury received money from persons who had defrauded the government. Grocery and other accounts were paid up. Promissory notes were paid or they were canceled. Finally, October 22nd, 1844, people were meeting. They had corporate meetings together in church, and later they met together in their homes. The sun set, and they prayed and they prayed. Sometime in the night, they began to realize there's no second coming. So all their eager expectation, everything they had done to prepare for that day, seemed like it was all for naught. And they began to taste the bitter disappointment. What an overwhelming sorrow consumed them. They gave up everything for what at that time seemed apparently nothing. Would we be willing to give up everything, knowing that it might not get us anything? That's the commitment that Jesus made to us. When he died on the cross, he was entirely willing to give everything, even if none of us should believe. In fact, he would give it all if only one of us would believe. Let's bow our heads for a closing word of prayer. Father in heaven, I pray that your grace would be upon us, that we may believe like those Millerite believers who unreservedly gave everything to the cause. And yet, they did not give up in the face of utter failure. Lord, I pray that you would give us that kind of faith, that kind of resolve. In Jesus' name, amen.